Now, just last week, we saw South Africa's national women's football team, Banyana Banyana, do the country proud by lifting their 7th COSAFA Championship title in 8 attempts. Now, this team, which completed the tournament, they completed this tournament undefeated. Also showed that there is strength in diversity, much like the Springbok rugby team did in Japan a year ago. Now, none of this would have been possible if Banyana Banyana did not have a good coach and leader. And that person is in Coach Desiree Ellis, who joins me this morning just to chat a bit more about Banyana and their success so far and where they are heading. Desiree, thank you so much for joining me this morning. 7th COSAFA title, 4th consecutive title for you guys. Does it feel the same every single time you win?
It's special every time. It was a different group, and due to COVID, it was obviously a challenge, you know, but the group stood up and we asked them to make their mark, and they definitely did.
I mean, you mentioned the fact that it was a different group and a whole lot of people were just like nervous. We don't know how this team is going to do. It was a couple of young players. I know that the 13 players that we're used to seeing in the national team, they weren't part of the team because they're playing abroad. But what does it say about the succession plan that you have? What's the system that you have in place to make sure that the new crop of players still give the results that we want?
Look, we've always used the COSAFA Cup for local base players. In 2017, we had 10 new players. Mm-hmm. And we thought similarly we're going to do the same. 9 players that played last year at the COSAFA Cup on our abroad. So obviously we had to look around and find other players. And there were only 7 players of the squad that were available. But we used some of the players we used when we played Lesotho. So we scouted last year, you know, National League, SASA League, other competitions, the national championships, the Cecil one in December. Mm. And we used some of those players against Lesotho in March. And the idea was the next camp, which was April, we were going to use the other players. But then COVID happened. So we sent out a group of, training programs to our whole group of players, a core group, and stayed in contact with everyone. And then hoping that football was still going to resume. And then we got to camp on the 20th of October, which didn't give us a lot of time. But training on your own is obviously different. So we, the fitness trainer and everybody else, got together and, you know, we really pushed the group in the beginning with the selection. Mm-hmm. And as the days went on, it got better and better. Then we went to Port Elizabeth to prepare. And the competition then started. And that's when, you know, the first game was very rusty. But mm-hmm. we just made players understand that they need to raise their hand. They need to make their mark and be remembered. And as the games went on, we got better. And what we wanted to do and challenge the group. And, you know, Andile as the leader, she really stood up for the team, and everybody just stuck together.
I mean, you know, sometimes we see coaches struggling to get a team together, especially a national coach, to get a team that does not, perhaps they don't spend time with them for a long time. And then when they come through, to get them gelling for a while, was it a struggle for you?
Look, not really. We just concentrated on what we needed to do, and we took the games game by game mm-hmm. and made sure that we implemented what we wanted to do, to share the ball around, our movement of the ball, our rotation, of the ball itself. Mm-hmm. It got better in every game. We were a bit concerned about the fitness levels, hadn't played for a while, and after the first game, there was a bit of stiffness and tightness, which was normal, mm-hmm. but we managed that well by rotating the team. Had interaction with the U20 coach as well, because we had 5 U20 players mm-hmm. in the group as well, which included Karabo and Sibuleli, who played at the World Cup last year. So it was just trying to bring in players all the time and making sure that we have, you know, a consistent pipeline of players coming through. Mm. Now we have a big core group, and now there's a couple of headaches here because, you know, players are raising their hands. But you'd rather have a big core group, you know, than not have, quality players. But there's most probably thousands we've missed already. Mm. But we will try our best to look at, as many players as we can. And hopefully, you know, there's a couple of gems out there that we can still find.
How do you rate this competition, the COSAFA Women's Championship? I mean, obviously it's Southern African competition, and the main aim or the main goal is, you know, Africa as a whole. But how do you see the competition in terms of the countries that you guys play against?
Look, I think the competition has improved. We never brought overseas-based players. Malawi brought the Chawinga sisters, who just completed their season, and they definitely raised the level of their team. Mm. Zambia had Barbara Banda, and they also started very early. Even Comoros, you could see they were much fitter, You know, they were much more structured and organized and knew what they wanted to do. So the teams were much better, you know, and we just, you know, consistently asked the players to raise their levels. So we had our analysts who really worked behind the scenes, getting as much as you could about the opposition. And that was, you know, laid out to the players. We had video sessions on how the opposition played. And then we went onto the field and worked out how we wanted to play. And the assistant coach was also key in here, sitting individually with players to make them understand their roles, you know. Mm. We had some players sitting down and say, this is important, that is important. And sometimes it didn't work in the game, and sometimes it did, but we just consistently kept going until, you know, it came right, I'd say, against Malawi, where in the first half we struggled a bit when they went down to 10. But we kept moving the ball around and we got better and better.
Let's talk about the pressures that you face as the head coach of a national team. I'm sure it's not easy going out there, making sure that you scout for the right talent. You've proved yourself year in, year out, and even now you're still succeeding. But some of the challenges that you come across as a national team coach, how have you overcome them?
Look, we know that, you know, sometimes clubs, because they don't have resources, they train twice a week. And unfortunately, you know, that's not what we're looking for in an international player. But there's a lot of interaction between us and the coaches down on the ground to help us. We send out regular training programs when once we've selected a squad. We send out training programs to make sure that everybody comes in at the same level. And the coaches at the clubs have been very, you know, very helpful. You know, they've assisted us in that way. I regularly go to games, but I don't see all the games, and some of the games are on television. So each and every coach out there is obviously a selector, you know, seeing players. We have other, you know, provincial technical officers last year was very key in helping us when we get a recommendation to go out and have a look. But the consistency that we might see a player this week and then we see a player in 3 weeks' time. So I'd like to really follow, you know, and monitor the player's progress, which is sometimes very difficult. But the coaches on the ground have been really fantastic in helping us, you know, in giving us information and assisting us in the programs as well.
Do you ever find yourself concerned? I mean, obviously it's a great thing to see Banyana players apply their trade abroad, but do you ever have that thing inside saying, I really wish she didn't go, but I know she has to go because, I mean, it's a great opportunity for them?
Never, never. I think, you know, players have goals as well, and players aspire to play abroad, and if the opportunity comes, you know, they should grab the opportunity with both hands, because you know, some of them go to smaller leagues and from there they get scouted to go to bigger to bigger and better teams. You look at Rafiel Benjani, you know, went to Australia and now she's playing in Italy. The same with Jermaine and Otando Vilakazi, went to Gintra and now they're playing in Spain and Portugal. So, you know, those are the opportunities that players get, and I will never tell a player not to go, because, I mean, that's their dream. You know, they have dreams. We have goals as a team, but they also have dreams. And I think, you know, we have a lot of talent in the country, but it took the World Cup for people to actually confirm or reaffirm that we have that talent. And now doors are just opening up for everyone. And I'm sure after this COSAFA Cup, which was screened live and it was streamed live, you know, there are most probably more doors being knocked on now, on the players' doors.
Absolutely. And I mean, I know that you can't say much with regards to this, but it's a topic at hand with regards to equal pay. And I was talking to Amanda Dlamini actually yesterday, and she was saying that it shouldn't only be at national level, but also at club level. But I just want you to just put into perspective for us, for people that don't understand, some of the struggles that perhaps female football players are experiencing in terms of if they don't have enough funding to push for their career to go further, because you've been a player before and you also deal with these players closely.
Look, we have one sponsor, which is Sasol. You know, we urge corporates to come on board. You know, Sasol sponsors the Sasol League as well, and Banyana. They've been fantastic since 2009. You look at other countries, the USA, you know, you look at, they have so many sponsors. And that will really help in, you know, bridging that little gap. That will really help if sponsors come on board and sponsor the National League, for example. You know, that will also help alleviate, because, you know, with the PSL, you look, there's grants that's been given to clubs, and through that, they can afford to pay their players. With the National League, that doesn't happen at this moment, you know. I think the teams that are better off are the teams connected to the PSL teams like Bloemfontein Celtic and Mamelodi Sundowns and the university teams because they have the resources. Mm-hmm. So we urge corporates all the time to come on board to make sure that we can take women's football to the next level. Mm-hmm. Our U17 and U20 national teams don't have sponsors. Can you just imagine if they had sponsors, mm-hmm. how far or how women's football would be elevated even further? And through that, sponsorship, you know, more can be done, and through sponsorship, you know, players can be paid, mm-hmm. and that is why we urge sponsors to come on board, you know, to take the pressure off Cecil a bit, because that's the only sponsor we currently have, mm-hmm. and if more sponsors come on board, more can be done.
Mm. And what's next for you now as a coach, obviously, in terms of your hopes for Banyana Banyana moving on to next year?
Look, we have next year probably COSAFA again. And we're not sure when the qualifiers is for AFCON, which is in 2022. That's going to be a big one because it's also a World Cup qualifier. So the preparation starts now, where we put everything in place now and make sure that we have a plan, you know, how we build up to that. Similarly to 2018, mm-hmm. Where we had a build-up leading up to the AFCON, where we had Cameroon at the COSAFA Cup, and that was a real test for us to say where we are. And it was a good test, so we knew we were on the right track. Mm-hmm. And making sure, you know, with all the players that we have now, making sure we get the right combinations, making sure that we get that all our bases are covered, and making sure that the players push themselves as well, because when they push each other, the level goes up. And we're hoping that the players that come from abroad, you know, can do similarly what Cameroon and Nigeria did when their players came from abroad, and you could see the professionalism coming off and rubbing on too, because they train every single day at mm-hmm. a high level and they play every week at a high level, and that will really help the national team, because the goal is, obviously, we've never won AFCON. You know, we've come very close, and I think 2018 was the closest. Mm-hmm. The aim is obviously to win it like every other country that goes to a tournament or to a match, and we're no different, and if we can win that, we automatically qualify for the World Cup, and then at the World Cup to do better and maybe get out of the group stages. You know, people might think we're too ambitious, but you've got to have some ambition.
Absolutely.
You know, you've got to have ambition, and players have goals as well. Mm. So, you know, all of those put together, we're hoping to achieve all of those.
Do you think we still have a long way to go before we see a professional league?
Look, we're not where we want to be. You know, the National League was a start, and there was a lot of hiccups, like anything that is new. And hopefully the National League can be better this time around, not just in terms of, you know, everything else that has happened, but also in terms of quality with the teams, that the gaps can be a bit smaller, teams can be more organized, because now you have a Champions League to fight for. Mm. And, you know, Mamelodi Sundowns went through the season unbeaten, which was incredible, you know. And now they will be the team that everybody will be chasing, and hopefully the league can be much tighter and the quality can be better. But, you know, if sponsors come on board, possibly we'll have a professional league sooner than later. But if the PSL teams, you know, come on board as well, because they are a brand on their own, the Kaizer Chiefs, the Orlando Pirates, etc., I think that will also attract more sponsors and take the teams to a different level.
Well, Coach, thank you very much for joining us today. We're just going to have to leave it there, but I'm wishing you nothing but the best moving forward, really. Looking forward to seeing Banyana Banyana actually win the AFCON. Thank you very much, man. That is Banyana Banyana head coach Desiree Ellis just letting us in on Banyana's success thus far and where they're heading to the future.